As per second part of the question, you said that there are many non-Muslim Hindus who say believe in Ishwar. So how do we answer them? And some say that you go to Dargah, we go to temple, what is the difference? So as far as a non-Muslim or a Hindu says he believes in Ishwar, you have to first try and find out what is the definition of Ishwar. If his definition of Almighty God, Ishwar, fits in the definition of Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4, which says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. Say he is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah the absolute eternal. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. He begets not, nor is begotten. وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. There is nothing like him. If that definition of Ishwar which he believes in falls in this four-line definition of Surah Ikhlas, we have no objection in accepting that person as true Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it doesn't fall, then it's a false Almighty God. As far as those people going to Dargah, see, anyone, whether he calls himself by any name, whether he calls himself by Abdullah, Zakir, Muhammad, Sultan, just by giving a Muslim name, a person does not become Muslim. So a person goes and worships anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is shirk. So if someone bows down to an idol, it is haram. If he bows down to a dead man, also it's haram. To a living man or to a grave is haram. So if someone does shirk, means worships. So if someone goes to Dargah and worships the grave, it is haram. Or asks from the grave, it's haram. But someone goes to the grave and does dua for the person, ask for forgiveness for the person who has died from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is fine. So if you go to a grave and ask for maghfirat of the person who has died, maybe your father, your grandfather, great grandfather, or a person you think is very holy, you can ask for forgiveness for that person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can pray for him, but you can't pray to him. So if you pray to anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that becomes shirk, irrespective of the person doing has a Muslim name or not. The person goes to Dargah and prays to anyone besides Allah, it is shirk. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikum assalam.
Writing a script for a play or a skit having more of entertainment and less of message, will that be encouraged in Islam?
The sister has a question that if you write a script or a play which has more of entertainment value, less of Islam, is it allowed? See, best is to write a script in which a person comes closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the best. But if you write a script which has entertainment value, which is not forbidden in Islam, or has entertainment value, which is not haram in Islam, it is mubah. Writing that script is also mubah. If all the activities of the play, the script, the actors, the message, if not a single portion, not 0.01 portion of that play comes under haram activity, then that play per se becomes mubah. Mubah means optional. But if you write a script which has an Islamic message, part Islamic, part entertainment, or two in one, that is the best. But even if you write a script which doesn't have any haram element in it, and if you write a script only for entertainment value, that comes under the category of halal entertainment. So if it is a halal entertainment without Islamic message, but not having even 0.001% of haram portion in it, writing such a script becomes mubah, allowed in Islam. But preferable is give an Islamic message. Hope that answers the question, sister. Any brothers have any questions? Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. How do we dawah to the deviated sects in Islam? How do you dawah to them?
Brother, the question that how do you do dawah to the various sects in Islam? Whichever sect is there in Islam, is clearly mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 103. Wa tasimu bihablillahi jamia wa la tafarraqu. Hold to the rope of Allah, strong name, be not divided. So Allah says, hold to the rope of Allah. The rope of Allah is the glorious Quran. The glorious Quran and the Sahih Hadith. So every Muslim should hold together to the glorious Quran and Sahih Hadith and be not divided. Quran clearly mentions in Surah An'am chapter number 6, verse number 159, that anyone who makes sects in the religion of Islam, O Prophet, you have nothing to do with him. So making sects in Islam is haram. And unfortunately, we have various sects among the Muslim community, various sects. It's clearly mentioned in the Quran several places, making sex is haram. If you analyze, what was the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What was he? He was a Muslim. So all the Muslims should go back to Quran and Sunnah. That is the reason the best way to do islah to a Muslim is whenever you give a reply, quote the Quran and Sahih Hadith. So once you start giving references, the people will come to know the truth from falsehood. So whenever you give a reply, always follow up with proof along with references. Many of the speakers, they give answers without referring to Quran and Sunnah, without giving references. So when you make it common in the general masses, that whatever answer you give, back it up with proof, with reference and quotation from Quran and Sunnah, there are chances to come back to twofold. And Islam is only one. It's not divided. Though our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's hadith, a sahih hadith of Tirmidhi, he said that there will be 73 sects in Islam. The Prophet didn't say he should make. There will be. Out of which, only one will go to Jannah. The people ask, which one? He said, those who follow the Prophet and the Sahabas. So, all those who are on the straight path, following Allah and His Rasul, and the beloved Prophet said that if you do not find in the Quran or in my Sunnah, look in the next generation, the Sahabas. If you don't find there, then look in the next generation. Then the next. That is Sahaba, Tabain, and then Tabi Tabain. So for example, for any proof or hujjah, we look into the Quran. If you don't find the Quran, look into the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Say hadith. If you don't find there, then the lifestyle of the Sahabas, then the Tabain, then the Tabi Tabain. So if you follow this, you're on the true path. Anyone who deviates from this path is not falling to Islam. Hope that answers the question. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum. You have just mentioned one hadith which says that there will be 73 sects in Islam. This hadith doesn't mention any time, exactly at what time it will be, whether in the just after the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or after 1 century or a 10th century or 20th century. It doesn't mention any time. Or whether all 73 will be there at a time, or it will be spreaded over till Qiyamah. So my question is, how useful is this hadith to mention or to quote when it doesn't specify anything which is going to help anyway?
The brother has asked a question that this hadith, that there will be 76, does not specify the time. Will it be together? Will it be in the 12th century or 13th century? I am saying the hadith says there will be. Surely it will be before Qiyamah. Now I am asking the question, even if it specifies, will it make a difference? If the hadith specified, suppose, for sake of argument, there will be 73 sects in the 12th century. Fine. It will continue. So for today, irrespective whether there are 72 sects, or 50 sects, or 30 sects, the Quran says don't make sects. So you should be more interested in following one which is on the straight path, that is Quran and Sunnah. I am not bothered whether there are 72 or 150. Suppose I tell you today there are 53 sects. Will it make a difference to you? So irrespective whether there are 2 sects today or 73 sects, 2 sects or 73 sects, your amal remains the same. You have to follow Quran and Sunnah. So what difference does it make? So the message is clear that there will be many sects. 73 is the number put by the Prophet. But even whether it is 50 or it is 30, your rules and guidance remain the same. It does not change. So for us, the message is clear that there will be many sects. You don't have to get involved in the sects. The one who's on the true path is the one who does not make sects. The sect which is on the true path is the one that does not make sects. Who says that? Quran says that. Surah An'am chapter 6 verse 159. So if you tell that the hadith doesn't carry weight, it is illogical. The hadith is sufficient. It is an evergreen hadith. Evergreen means it applied at the time of the Prophet. It will apply today. It will apply till Qiyamah. Because the logic is the same. If you'd have mentioned the time, then it may have been time bound. Then somebody said, okay, Prophet said 12th century, now in 21st century, it may not be there, it may be there. So the Prophet's hadith is, mashallah, he is much more intelligent than you and me. So what he has said is, alhamdulillah, perfect. It's an evergreen, it can be applied to all times. And irrespective of whether you live today, or tomorrow, or yesterday, the hadith is applicable. It's telling us to go back to Quran and Sunnah. Follow Allah and His Messenger and the 3 rightly guided generations. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
This is in reference to the hadith where Prophet said that on the day of Qiyamah, unhorned animal will take its revenge with the animal not having a horn, and then they will become dust. Now, do the animals have the concept of morality or something of oppression kind of? Do they have the choice?
This is a very good question. That the animals, there are various hadith talking about this. Suppose one animal has wronged the other animal. On the day of judgment, that animal will be made to attack and then they go in the dust. Here we realize that, relates to my earlier answer, which I gave, that we human beings are undergoing the test. These animals are already Muslims. They have submitted their will to God. But yet, they have their rules and regulations. But as far as submitting the will to God, they have submitted. But while submitting the will to God, whatever little bit here and there which is allowed in their way of life, if they have wronged some other animal, that hisab kitab will be on day of judgment, and then both will become absolutely finished. There's no Jannah and Jahannam for them. It is for the human beings. For us, we are undergoing the test. For the animals, it's not there. That they are already Muslims. They are submitting will to God. So for them, they'll just pass the test. So that is the reason if while passing the test, if they have made certain mistakes, like if they have unnecessarily harmed another animal, that animal will be able to harm him back, and then the account will be nil for both, and that will be the end of the case. For us, after the day of judgment, depending upon a deed, good or bad, we'll go to heaven or hell. Hope that answers the question, sister. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.